Greetings to our beloved church family. In Hebrews 12:14, we are told to pursue peace and holiness with all people. This is what we need in times like these. Let's prepare our hearts for worship. Our call to worship can be found in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 23, verses 5 and 6. The days are coming, says the Lord, I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and Israel will live in safety, and this is the name by which he will be called. The Lord is our righteousness. Let us worship him.
many great things. Bless his holy, bless his holy name. Wonderful, his holy name. His wonderful, wonderful name. He's brought us from a long, long way.
Bless his holy name.
Bless his holy name.
Let us bow our heads for a quick word of prayer. Dear Jesus, we just want to thank you for granting us this opportunity we have today to gather together and to just give thanks for everything that you've done for us throughout our lives, oh Lord. We also, in this time, want to pray for those who have been affected in any way by COVID-19. We pray that you'll be with those who have been affected, those who are sick from this disease. We pray that you'll lay your healing hands on them and get rid of this disease that's affecting their bodies, oh Lord. We also want to take this time to apologize for any of the things that we've said, done, thought that may have upset you in any way. Please, we know that without you, we are nothing, and we just pray that you forgive us of our sins and just let us have a good rest of the week, O Lord. Just pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand from where you're seated and let's proclaim the goodness of our God through these songs.
Days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And these are the days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword. Still we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare.
It's all about you. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. Cause it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. All about you.
Good afternoon, church. I trust everyone is doing well. And I'm glad to be back to lead you in the study of God's Word. But before we do that, let us all bow our heads in prayer. Lord, we thank you for the gift of your Word. And as we study and meditate on it, please open our hearts and our minds to hear you. Holy Spirit, I invoke your presence and please minister to each one tuned in to this live stream. In Jesus' sweet name I pray. Amen. I'm glad to be back and lead us in the study of God's Word. And the title of my message is, Are You Living in Victory? And our text is in the New Testament book of Luke, chapter 1 through 10. Some Christians never live in victory because we never fully comprehend the total victory of Jesus and our ability by faith to take possession of all he has done for us. This afternoon, we will look at the subject and reveal Jesus' total triumph over sin and his ability to save anyone who wishes to come to him despite their sin. If you have your Bibles with you, please follow me as I read our text for this afternoon. Again, Luke 19, 1 through 10. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be the guest of a sinner. But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because this man, too, is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. You see, everything Jesus did had a purpose, and in this afternoon study, we will find that although Jesus was heading to the cross in Jerusalem, as was said in Luke chapter 18, he made a detour through Jericho, which is a longer route. And the question is, why did Jesus do this? We will discover the answer in the 3 points I'd like to highlight this afternoon. So we will look at first, the sin, the second, the sinner, and third, the Savior. So let's get started. First is the sin. Jericho, meaning to blow, for example, breathe, to smell by implication, perceive, accept, smell, touch, make up quick understanding, is a type of our natural senses or understanding. In Joshua chapter 6, we find that Jericho was the first city Israel came to after they crossed the River Jordan and entered the Promised Land. Jericho was the gateway to Canaan, or in New Testament terms, the stronghold or things that hold us back from taking possession of the promises of God. God gave Israel a set of instructions to follow in order to see the city fall. Israel's obedience to follow those instructions and see this obstacle that is Jericho destroyed was an act of faith. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 30, it says, by faith, walls of Jericho fell after the army had marched around them for 7 days. Today, our strongholds come down and the promises of God are appropriated when by faith we obey God's word. But Joshua, foreseeing events that could take place, made this declaration. Again, Joshua 6:26, it says, at that time, Joshua pronounced this solemn oath, cursed before the Lord is the one who undertakes to reveal the city, Jericho. At the cost of his firstborn son, he will lay its foundations. At the cost of his youngest, he will set its gates. Notice here, the firstborn in the Old Testament represented the promise of a future and a savior. So in effect, Joshua was saying, if you allow Jericho's in your life, you will lose your ability to access the promises of God. In 1 Kings chapter 16, verse 34, it says, in Ahab's time, Hiel of Bethel rebuilt Jericho. He laid its foundation at the cost of his firstborn son, Abiram, and he set up its gates at the cost of his youngest son, Segub, in accordance with the word of the Lord spoken by Joshua, son of Nun. You see, this act by Hiel cost him his promise, his firstborn. The rebuilt walls of Jericho represented disobedience to God's word because of unbelief or doubt. Jesus then, our true Joshua, had to pass through Jericho because it represented Satan's stronghold of unbelief and disobedience and doubt. Jesus had to see these spiritual walls demolished and prove that even in the midst of the situation, there he could save the worst sinner. Which leads us to the second point, the sinner. Zacchaeus means just or pure. He was called the son of Abraham. Abraham, we are told, was the father of faith, and through him, faith promises were obtained. In Romans 4, verse 16, it says, "Therefore the promise comes by faith, so that it may be by grace and may be guaranteed to all Abraham's offspring, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who have the faith of Abraham. He is the father of us all." You see, not only that, but Zacchaeus' name was a play on living by faith. Romans 1:17 says, "For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith." But Zacchaeus was not living by faith. Our passage tells us he had a reputation of being a sinner, and not only that, he was a chief tax collector, one who impoverished the people, mistreated and stole from them, as was the custom of the day. He worked for the Romans, who represent a type of the world. So our son of faith was not living by faith. He was living and controlled by his senses, and as such was a prisoner of Satan. Zacchaeus represents then the most imprisoned by sin, person living in the revealed city of unbelief, doubt, and disobedience. In other words, Satan's chief prize. Jesus then went to Jericho to demonstrate his complete victory over sin and Satan, to prove that no one is unreachable by God. This brings us to the third point, the Savior. Jesus Christ, meaning the Lord is salvation, equals Joshua. What does Jesus find when he comes into Jericho? Does Jesus find proof that the inhabitants of this border town still rely on God and God alone to defend and preserve the promised land? Do the ruins of the collapsed wall of the city still remind the present inhabitants of the city that the promised land was a gift received by faith alone? A gift that can be retained by faith alone? Tragically, the answer is no. What Jesus finds is a new fortification or barricade. Despite the command of God not to rebuild the walls of Jericho, those walls were rebuilt, and he finds Zacchaeus. Jesus is on his way to that confrontation with Satan. He is on his way to destroy the kingdom of Satan and establish the kingdom of God. Jesus entered the city and straight away did battle with Satan. thousands of people lived in the city. Yes, the countless of them were firmly in the grip of the evil one. But one of those who were firmly in the grip of the devil, Jesus publicly plucked out of the devil's grasp. For in the heart of Zacchaeus, God worked fate. The tax collector, who had by one obsession in life, was moved by the Spirit of Jesus Christ to yearn to see the rabbi from Nazareth. Instead of that daring character elbowing his way to the front of the crowd, and so being caught up by whatever mood the crowd might have, Zacchaeus chose a quiet spot above the people from which to observe the Lord more closely. He climbed that fig tree or the sycamore tree. When Jesus passed under the particular tree where the curious tax collector was perched, he made a point of looking up and speaking to the man in the tree. Jesus knew where Zacchaeus was. He knew what the man's name was and knew that Zacchaeus had a house. This in itself was already a show of heavenly strength in the stronghold of Satan. But a greater show of heavenly strength was still to come. In verse 5 of our text, Jesus said, when Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. Jesus declares that it is necessary for him to stay, to spend time in this city of unbelief, to stay specifically at the house of an apostate, no less than Zacchaeus, the chief tax collector. You see, here is an affront or embarrassment to Satan. Satan cannot keep Jesus outside Jericho. Satan cannot bind Jesus in Jericho. Satan must watch helplessly as Jesus sovereignly prepares for himself a place to stay. As Jesus settles down in the home of his choice. Well, why is that? The reason why is that to demonstrate at the entrance of the promised land that Satan is not greater than he. So Jesus walks into the house of that hardened sinner Zacchaeus, and Satan cannot do anything about it. More, he takes that hardened sinner Zacchaeus and rescues him from Satan's grip, restores him to God's side. The evidence that Jesus, in fact, does snatch the sinner from Satan's grasp is clear. Jesus works faith in him. Jesus gives him a new heart so that he is willing to give half of his wealth to the poor and pay back fourfold whatever he had defrauded. The Old Testament had commanded robbers, extortionists, and money finders to give a full refund to their victim plus one-fifth for restitution. That was all. And we find that in Leviticus chapter 6, 1 through 5. Zacchaeus would give half his possessions to the poor, 50% gone. He would also pay back four times those he defrauded. statute of limitation gone. And he would give them here and now. Interest gone. Verses 8 through 10 of our text says, "But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, 'Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount.' Jesus said to him, 'Today, salvation has come to this house, because this man, too, is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost.'" But the question then is why? His heart, his will, his mind, his affections had been changed. Heart equals center of this man's was Jesus. When it comes to will, that's equal from self-willed to doing God's will. What about mind? Mind equals new thoughts of giving rather than getting. And what about affections? That's equal loved the people he once hated and cheated. And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because he also is the son of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost." You see, Christ coming into the house of Zacchaeus, working faith in the heart of this one inhabitant of Jericho, boils down in essence to a repeat of the destruction of the wall of Jericho, as described in Joshua chapter 6. Inasmuch as the fall of Jericho in the days of the first Joshua foretold the coming destruction of all Canaanites, so also this fall of one child of Satan from Satan's hands foreshadow the coming destruction of Satan and his whole domain. But the question is, but what is salvation? It comes from a Greek word, soteria, meaning rescue or safety, physically or morally. Deliver, health, salvation, save, saving, do well, be or make whole. Salvation then is complete wholeness in spirit, soul, and body. But salvation came that day in a much fuller sense than only in the conversion of Zacchaeus. Salvation was guaranteed that day to the entire world because Christ entered the stronghold of Satan and bound the strong man so as to release one of his victims. And so he opened for himself the whole land for victory. He came to the gateway of the promised land, understood the symbolism of Jericho and the influence of Satan in the city and in the land, and with one word sent the walls of Satan's kingdom crashing down. Jericho and the walls in our lives. Zacchaeus had some walls to come down in his life, much like ourselves. But rather than scale these walls ourselves, God has placed the victory before us and through Jesus Christ. Ephesians 2:14 says, "For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one, and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility. I want to end our study with this. There is a wall of sin, wall of unbelief, wall of doubt, wall of slavery to other things, walls of rejection, walls of apathy, and so forth. The question is, are we living in Jericho? Many people, upon salvation, destroy their walls of Jericho and start to walk in the promises of God. But over time, we rebuild those walls again and wonder where our promises. This afternoon, let Jesus re-enter our Jerichos and pull those walls down again. Let us be like Zacchaeus, who sought to see who Jesus was. Let us pray. Father, we know that life is full of ups and downs for everyone, even the most diligent spiritual warrior. Help us, Lord, to work through these jolts of the unexpected and unwelcome interruptions that bring sadness, disappointment, or a change of perfect plans. It's how you work your purpose in our lives as we overcome and work through major obstacles that affect us. We seek to remain steadfast, Lord, moving forward in our Christian walk as we experience the inevitable headaches of life. At times, we bring about our own grief and troubles because of our ungodly action. We thank you for your forgiveness in these matters. You enable us to get up, take off the sandcloth, the sackcloth, and brush off the burnt ashes from doing things our own way. And you give us fresh resolve to trust and obey you through Jesus Christ, our Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Jesus, my Savior.
Our sending forth can be found in the book of Ephesians, chapter 2, verses 9 and 20. So you are no longer strangers and aliens, and also members of the household of God, with Christ himself as the cornerstone.
Lord, we thank you for this wonderful worship service that we've done online. We thank you, dear Father, for continually providing us with your blessings. We thank you for our speaker today, Pastor Oscar, who delivered the message. May you bless him, O Lord, and use him. And we pray that we will be able to use and apply the message that you have given through your word and through your speaker today. We also pray for each and every one of us that you will protect us, keep us from harm, and the Holy Spirit will be able to equip us with the spiritual gifts that you have given to each and everyone to lead and to use for your glory and for your kingdom. And as we end our worship, may your blessing through the Holy Spirit be bestowed upon each and every one of us. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling, to present you without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, Jesus Christ, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, now and forevermore. Amen. Oh,